Once upon a time, in a land of rolling hills and golden fields, there ruled a king named Saul. He was tall and strong, with a heart full of promise. The people loved him and hoped for a prosperous and peaceful reign. King Saul had been chosen by the prophet Samuel, who had poured a flask of oil over his head, anointing him as the first king of Israel. Saul ruled over the land with wisdom and kindness, and the people rejoiced under his rule. But as time passed, Saul's heart changed. He became proud and sometimes made decisions without thinking. God had given Saul important instructions, but he didn't always follow them. This is the story of the four main reasons behind King Saul's tragic downfall. In the beginning, Saul's authority over Israel stayed mostly in the military realm. He spent little time on internal affairs and was not engaged in matters of faith. One day, Saul was preparing for a war against the enemy. His soldiers were waiting for his orders at the battlefield. Prophet Samuel asked Saul to perform a sacrifice before the battle, as instructed by God. Samuel asked Saul to wait for some time. Saul waited 7 days for Samuel, but Samuel still didn't come. He realized that his troops were rapidly slipping away, so he demanded,
"Bring me the burnt offering and the peace offerings."
And Saul sacrificed the burnt offering himself. Just as Saul was finishing with the burnt offering, Samuel arrived.
"What is this you have done?"
"I saw my men scattering from me, and you didn't arrive when you said you would. So I felt compelled to offer the burnt offering myself before you came."
"How foolish! You have not kept the command the Lord your God gave you. Now your kingdom must end."
Saying this, Samuel walked away angrily. Saul had forgotten that true leadership requires humility and obedience, and his actions only hastened his downfall. Now the spirit of the Lord had departed from Saul, and an evil spirit from the Lord tormented him. The evil spirit whispered lies and deceit into Saul's ear, deepening his descent into despair and madness. In moments of weakness, Saul was tormented by the evil spirit. His mind became a battleground, and his actions became increasingly erratic. One of Saul's attendants saw his master's torture and realized what was going on.
"Master, an evil spirit from God is tormenting you."
"Huh?"
"Let our Lord command his servants here to search for someone who can play the lyre."
"A lyre?"
"He will play when the evil spirit from God comes on you, and you will feel better."
Yes, that's a good idea. Find someone who plays well, and bring him to me."
"I have seen a son of Jesse of Bethlehem, who knows how to play the lyre. He speaks well, and is a fine-looking man."
Saul sent his messengers to Jesse's house, who was David's father.
"David!"
David, a young shepherd with a heart full of music, found himself in an unexpected twist of fate when he was summoned to play his lyre for King Saul. As David entered the grand chamber of the palace, he felt a rush of nervous excitement.
"Play some music now!"
With a deep breath, David plucked the strings of his lyre, conjuring a melody that seemed to transcend earthly boundaries. His fingers danced on the strings, each note resonating like a balm for Saul's troubled soul. The king's eyes softened and his tense shoulders relaxed. Saul, moved beyond words, rose from his seat and embraced David.
You have brought light to the darkness of my soul.
From that day forward, whenever the evil spirit came on Saul,
"Get me David."
David would come as fast as he could. The young shepherd would take up his lyre and play. Saul would get relief after listening to the music. He would feel better, and the evil spirit would leave him. Saul's once strong spirit was now vulnerable, and the evil spirit seized the opportunity to sow despair and confusion. One day, the Philistine army challenged the Israelites for a war. They had a giant named Goliath in their army. Goliath was huge, with armor that gleamed in the sun, and he taunted the Israelites to find a warrior to face him.
"Why don't you come out and line up for battle? Choose a man, and if he is able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us."
King Saul, the ruler of Israel, was worried, but David stepped forward. When the whole country was helpless, David stepped in. He believed that with God's help, he could defeat the giant. King Saul gave David his blessing and his armor, but David felt uncomfortable wearing the bulky armor. He decided to face Goliath with just a sling and 5 smooth stones. As David approached Goliath, the giant laughed and mocked him, but David didn't waver. He aimed his sling and, with a single stone, he struck Goliath in the forehead. Goliath fell to the ground, defeated. The people of Israel cheered, and David's bravery made him a hero. King Saul recognized David's faith and courage, and they became friends. After a few days, he saw people still singing songs of triumph about David. King Saul felt a bitter jealousy toward David.
"Why do they cheer for David more than me?"
His heart grew dark, and he saw David as a threat to his throne. Saul's jealousy led him to make foolish decisions. He began to view David as an enemy rather than a loyal subject. He plotted to harm David, even though David had only served the kingdom with unwavering loyalty.
"I'll send David on dangerous missions. Maybe he'll get hurt."
He forgot about being a good king and started making bad choices.
"Saul, you're losing your way. Remember, it's important to follow God's commands."
Saul's heart became more troubled. He did things that weren't right. As Saul's story progresses, the mistakes get bigger and the stakes get higher. Saul valued the opinion of the people over God's wisdom. He feared people when he should have feared God. His self-ignorance is shown even greater when one day God commands Saul to go and fight against the Amalekites. He was given clear instructions to thoroughly defeat the Amalekites. However, Saul stopped short and allowed the soldiers to plunder the spoil. Even though he was explicitly told to not let this happen. When Samuel confronts him, Saul somewhat confesses, but with a spin.
"The people spared the best of the sheep and oxen to make a sacrifice to Yahweh."
"Why then did you not listen to the voice of the Lord?"
"I did listen to the voice of Yahweh and went on the mission he sent me. But the people took the spoil."
Samuel pointed out that his error was trying to please his people instead of God.
"I have sinned because I feared the people and listened to their voice."
One night, in a fit of rage, Saul gathered his soldiers and set out to capture David once and for all. But as he entered a cave where he believed David was hiding, he found himself at David's mercy. David could have taken Saul's life, but instead, he spared him. Yet the story took a tragic turn in the next months. In a battle against their common enemies, the Philistines, Saul's sons were killed, and he was mortally wounded. Realizing the consequences of his actions, he took his own life rather than fall into enemy hands. Saul's tragic reign reminds us that leadership is a sacred trust, a responsibility to be carried out with wisdom and integrity. May his story guide us in making choices that honor the divine and uplift those we are called to serve. Once upon a time, in a faraway land, there lived a mighty king named Nebuchadnezzar. He was the ruler of the great Babylonian Empire, a land of grand palaces, lush gardens, and towering walls. King Nebuchadnezzar was a powerful and wealthy king, and he had many wise advisors who helped him rule his kingdom. One night, King Nebuchadnezzar had a very strange and puzzling dream. It was a dream that left him feeling anxious and troubled. He wanted to know the meaning of this dream. So he called upon his wise advisors, the magicians, astrologers, and sorcerers.
I have had a dream that troubles me, and I want to know what it means.
The astrologers knew that their king had a short temper, and that he would punish them harshly if they couldn't interpret his dream correctly. So they told,
O king, live forever. Tell your servants the dream, and we will interpret it.
Nebuchadnezzar realized this was their trick to escape punishment. He replied,
This is what I have firmly decided. If you do not tell me what my dream was and interpret it, you and your family will be killed by the sword. But if you tell me the dream and explain it, you will receive from me gifts and rewards and great honor.
Once more, they replied,
Let the king tell his servants the dream, and we will interpret it.
The king was certain they were trying to gain more time.
If you do not tell me the dream, there's just one penalty for you. You have conspired to tell me misleading and wicked things all this time, and the punishment is death.
There is not a man on earth who can do what the king asks. No king has ever asked such a thing from any magician or astrologer. What the king asks is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods.
This made the king so angry and furious that he ordered the execution of all the wise men of Babylon. In anger, the king gave the command to begin killing his wise men. This included Daniel and his three friends, known by the Babylonian names Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
I have bad news, my friend.
When Daniel learned of the king's decree to kill his advisors, Daniel requested an opportunity to tell the king his dream and its interpretation. Daniel's request was granted, and before meeting the king, Daniel shared the news with his three friends. They proceeded to pray all night with three of his fellow exiles. All of them then prayed to God for his help and their deliverance from what appeared to be certain death. God then revealed both the king's dream and its meaning in a vision to Daniel. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven.
I thank and praise you, O God of my fathers. You have given me wisdom and power. You have made known to me what we asked of you.
Are you able to tell me what I saw in my dream and interpret it?
No wise man, magician, or astrologer can explain to the king the mystery of his dreams. But there is a God in heaven who reveals mysteries. He has shown King Nebuchadnezzar what will happen in days to come.
Daniel then explained what the king had seen.
You looked, O king, and there before you stood a large statue, an enormous, dazzling statue, awesome in appearance. The head of the statue was made of pure gold, its chest and arms of silver, its belly and thighs of bronze, its legs of iron, its feet partly of iron and partly of baked clay. Then a stone was cut from a mountain, and it struck the feet of the statue. The statue was crushed into powder and blew away in the wind. The stone became a large mountain, and it filled the earth.
The king was stunned to hear this.
Go on.
Your Majesty, you are the King of Kings. The God of heaven has given you dominion and power and might and glory. In your hands he has placed all mankind and the beasts of the field and the birds in the sky. Wherever they live, he has made you ruler over them all. The head represents your current kingdom. You are that head of gold. God said there will be another kingdom, and it will be a kingdom that is characterized by the silver chest part of the statue. This will follow your rule. As silver is inferior to gold, so will be the kingdom that follows your time. Next, a third kingdom, one of bronze, will rule over the whole earth. Like the bronze is inferior to gold and silver, this kingdom will be inferior to their previous rulers. Finally, there will be a fourth kingdom, strong as iron, for iron breaks and smashes everything. And as iron breaks things into pieces, so it will crush and break all the others. This period will rule the kingdom harshly and conquer neighboring states. Just as you saw that the feet and toes were partly of baked clay and partly of iron, so this will be a divided kingdom. Yet, it will have some of the strength of iron in it, even as you saw iron mixed with clay. As the toes were partly iron and partly clay, so this kingdom will be partly strong and partly brittle.
King Nebuchadnezzar sat in awe, listening to Daniel's words.
In the time of those kings, the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that will never be destroyed, nor will it be left to another people. The stone represents the kingdom of God, a kingdom that will come and destroy all other kingdoms. It will crush all those kingdoms and bring them to an end. During this time, God will set up a kingdom in heaven that will never be destroyed. The new kingdom would destroy the other kingdoms and will be the kingdom to stand forever. The great God has shown the king what will take place in the future. The dream is true, and its interpretation is trustworthy.
Nebuchadnezzar fell down in front of Daniel with his face to the ground.
Your God revealed this dream to you. There is no God like him.
Instead of killing Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar bowed down in front of Daniel, and he gave Daniel many gifts. He put Daniel in charge of all the wise men, and gave Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego very important jobs also. Even so, Daniel and his friends continued to serve in the land of Babylon, sharing their faith and wisdom with others. The dream of the shining statue taught them that no matter how powerful or mighty earthly kingdoms may seem, God's kingdom is the one that will endure forever. While many people debate on the significance of each empire's of the statue, everyone unanimously agrees that it is the kingdom set up by God that crushes and puts an end to the other kingdoms.